What's up, YouTube? Welcome back to the Gears and Tool channel. Today we are going to be looking at a bunch of Goal Zero solar panels and trying to answer the question of which panels are going to be best for your use case scenario. So let's introduce the panels really quick and then we'll get right into the review. First up, we have the Nomad 28 watt solar panel. Then we have two of the Nomad 20 solar panels. And finally, for the ultra portable category, we have two of the Nomad 7 solar panels, which I'm sure these are very familiar to most of you guys, because if you've ever bought one of the kits for charging your cell phone or the kind of the portable mobile electronics battery pack that they sell, they usually come packaged with one of the Nomad 7 solar panels. So this is the what I call the ultra portable category. We are also going to be testing a Boulder 50 watt solar panel and a Goal Zero Boulder 100 briefcase watt solar panel. And the reason we're comparing the two different categories, kind of the larger glass solar panels to these ultra portable ones, is does it make sense maybe to buy a couple of these larger ones instead of one of the really big heavy glass panels? So let's take a quick look at each one individually and then we'll put them to the test and come back and answer that question. Okay, to start off, we're gonna look at the Goal Zero Nomad 7. Now this is the smallest solar panel that we're gonna look at today, but it is really small and compact, which means it packs away very easily. It folds up like this, and when you open it, you have two small solar panel sections, which are plastic, which is nice because then you don't have to worry about breaking it if it's in your backpack, gets dropped, things like that. This is a very rugged unit. It's waterproof or water resistant. I mean, if you dunked it, it'd probably, you know, have a problem on the back. But on the front, it's basically waterproof, rainproof, so that's very convenient. And then on the back, let's take a look at the adapters that come with it. If I can open it. You have three cables. The first is this very small output cable. And then this is for things such as the Goal Zero battery pack. If you look, it has a very small input. So this input is intended for the Nomad 7, which is this guy here. You can also chain with this. If you look in here, you have another input. So you can chain with the Nomad 7 with other Nomad 7s. Additionally, you have this larger output. This is for things such as the Yeti 400 or chaining with other larger Goal Zero solar panels. And we'll try that out in a little bit. And then additionally, you have this USB output port, which is nice because it essentially makes this solar panel usable with anything. If you have a phone charger, a battery pack that can be plugged into a USB port, anything like that, this solar panel will work with that. Now the downside is since it is a smaller solar panel, there are gonna be some times when it's not generating enough power to power those USB devices, especially if you have a larger phone or something like that. So keep that in mind, but those are the options that come on the back of the Nomad 7, and we'll be putting them to the test in a little bit. All right, let's take a real quick look at the Nomad 20. Now this Nomad 20 is very similar to the Nomad 7 we just looked at. The main difference is the panels are a little bit bigger, and there's three of them instead of two. I do like that Goal Zeros include a bunch of these little loops. It makes it very easy to hang this from camping gear or the backs of chairs, things like that. These panels are also made of plastic, like the Nomad 7, which makes it very durable. On the back, we again have a zipper pouch. Now the connections are a little bit different in this particular device. We do have the miniature output, similar to the Nomad 7. But we also have a larger input for chaining with your larger solar panels, such as the Boulder 100, the Boulder 50, the Nomad 28. Or you can plug this into one of those panels with the larger output that it has. And this is on a relatively long cable, about 6 feet. So you can position these panels right where the sun is hitting them best. And then you also have an included USB adapter, or it's not an adapter, it's plugged right into the panel itself, which is great for your mobile devices. Next, we are going to take a look at the Nomad 28. And just like the Nomad 7 and Nomad 20, the 28 means 28 watts. Now, this is a four-panel design, and each panel is larger than what you would find on like the Nomad 7. And again, these panels are made of plastic, so they're not very fragile. I actually like the design of this. It's easy to see, and it compacts into a relatively small package. On the back, we have a zipper pouch, which has the following cables in it. One is a relatively long power port for things like the Yeti 400 or chaining with other similar solar panels through this input adapter that's on a relatively short cable. And then in here, you also have a USB power adapter in case you want to charge your mobile devices or power something else that does not have the included Goal Zero connector integrated into it. On the back of the Nomad 28, you also have the included kickstand for aligning the solar panel with whichever direction the sun is coming in from. But also the kickstand is held on by magnets, so you can just pop it right off if you don't need it, and the cables will come pull right through this hole here, and you can dispose of the kickstand for later use. Hey guys, I just wanted to inject this into the video, just wrapped up the testing that you'll see in just a little bit, but the Nomad 28, the kickstand is held on by the magnets. The magnets came off in the heat from leaving the panel in the sun. This is kind of concerning because A, it was all four magnets. It wasn't just one of them. It was all four of them. And you know, this is an all black solar panel designed to be left in the sun. It's going to get hot. Currently in Arizona, it's around 100 degrees, but still an all black solar panel that's going to be left in the sun, it's going to get hot, and the glue holding the magnets on definitely in every instance failed. So just want to be fully transparent with you. The panel itself worked great, but the kickstand may not be the best design. This is the Boulder 50. It's the smaller of the rigid panels from Goal Zero, but it does put off quite a bit of power, and it's very versatile as it works in partly cloudy conditions and full sun. It comes with a nice kickstand to help you angle it toward the sun. On the back of the Boulder 50, you have these two connectors. One is the 8mm output, one is the 8mm input. You do not have a USB style output, but I think the adapter that comes with some of the Nomad panels would work with this panel. Similar to the Boulder 50, the Boulder 100 has a kickstand, which helps you angle the panel at an optimum angle. Something to note about the Boulder 100 is that it only has one 8mm output. It does not have an 8mm input for chaining. And I think that's because this box is using that input to chain to the panel next to it. And that panel does not have an 8mm input. So keep that in mind. We have all the solar panels laying flat on the grass. And the reason we're doing this instead of tilting them is I can't really tilt them all exactly the same angle. The sun is almost perfectly directly overhead. It's about noon right now. The UV index is 10. So this is really a pretty ideal situation for these panels. You know, if you just throw these out flat in the morning, let your battery charge all day, you wouldn't have to move it. It wouldn't require any repositioning. So it's the easiest deployment, the most consistent deployment. So we're gonna do this for the side-by-side comparison today. Okay, we're gonna go ahead and plug in our 30-foot extension cord. That way we can quickly switch from panel to panel without moving our entire setup. I'm gonna go ahead and plug in the Nomad 7. Something to note real quick is the Nomad 7 has a much shorter 8mm plug than the rest of the panels do. So something to keep note of, you might need a extension cord if you're gonna use this with a larger battery pack, such as the Yeti 400. Okay, we have the Nomad 7 plugged in, and it's putting off 4 watts right now, which is less than the 7-watt rating that the panel is rated for. We are about noon in Arizona in July, so a pretty ideal scenario. 4 watts is definitely enough to power a cell phone or a small battery pack, something like that. But keep in mind these panels as we go through them are not gonna be putting off the total rating. So if you need 10 watts, you should probably buy something bigger than 10 watts, especially if you're gonna be using it in conditions that might be partly cloudy and stuff like that where it deteriorate the performance of the panel. Okay, we're plugged into the Nomad 20 now, and it's pushing about 15, 16 watts. And that's pretty good since it's rated only 20 watts. So it's 75% there, which is better than the Nomad 7 was doing. So let's see how the Nomad 28 does, and we'll keep moving up. Okay, we had to move the battery and camera inside because it's over 100 degrees outside, and my camera was overheating. So another great reason to have a extension cord with your setup is the battery may not like being out in 100 degree plus heat. When it's sunny, it's typically warm. So we're inside, the extension cord is running outside to the solar panels. Currently we're hooked up to the Nomad 20 panel, and we are pulling about 15 watts outside. And when we moved inside, the sun is still going strong, we're pulling 16 watts. So we're gonna go ahead and move to the Nomad 28 and see how it performs. Okay, we have the Nomad 28 plugged in, and it's pushing about 20 watts right now, which is pretty decent. I am noticing as we go up in size on these solar panels, they're holding the output more consistently. The smaller panels seem to bounce around a little more than the larger panels do. Let's go ahead and move up to the Boulder 50. Okay, we have the Boulder 50 plugged in, and it's pulling about 40. So it's been a couple hours since we've tested the Boulder 50. We had to wait for some clouds to clear off, but the Boulder 100 is still pulling in about 73 watts, which is pretty good considering the sun is a little bit lower on the horizon. It's about 2:30 right now. So based on the Boulder 50 pulling 40 watts at high noon, I think the Boulder 100, safe to say, would be pushing a little over 80 watts, which is really good. You can charge the Yeti 400 in about 5 hours with 80 watts of input. Okay, the Boulder 100 definitely puts off the most power given the same amount of sunlight, but it's also the most expensive and the heaviest, coming in at 26 pounds. So let's go ahead and take a quick comparison of all these panels against cost, weight, and size. I'll chart them out so you guys can make the best decision for your specific use case scenario. Okay, so the question you guys clicked on this video to find out, which one is best? Well, like a lot of things, it depends. Here's a quick overview of the panels we tested today. The lightest panel is the Nomad 7, no surprise there. And then the panel that puts off the most power is the Boulder 100, which, no surprise there. But what does this all really mean? Let's dig into it a little bit more. If we take a look at the cost per watt that you're buying when you pick up one of these panels, your Nomad 7 is going to be by far the most expensive panel, costing you $14 per watt. So if the portability is extremely important to you, you can do that, but it costs almost four times as much as the Boulder panels. Both the Boulder 50 and the Boulder 100 only cost $3 a watt. So Goal Zero really makes you pay a premium for portability. If you don't need that portability, I would strongly recommend you buy one of the Boulder panels. It definitely gives you more bang for your buck. That being said, the Boulder panels are significantly heavier and larger than the Nomad panels for the same watt output. For example, the Boulder 100 is 4.1 ounces per watt output, while the Nomad 20, for example, is 1.8 ounces per watt, less than half the weight per watt. Additionally, the Nomad 20 is only 5.3 cubic inches per watt output, where the Boulder 100 is almost 22 cubic inches per watt output. That being said, I think the Nomad series panels are trying to address a different need than the Boulder panels. The Nomad panels are something you can throw in your backpack, carry with you somewhere, and empower mobile devices such as your phone, maybe a laptop charger, small items like that. The Boulder panels are really meant to be put in the back of a vehicle, a camper, something like that, and become a base station, charging something like the Yeti 400 I have, or one of the larger battery packs, such as the Yeti 1000 or even bigger. The Boulder panels are really trying to solve a different need than the Nomad panels are. If you need portability, go with one of the Nomad panels. But if you just need raw power and portability is not an issue, then the Boulder panels, hands down, are the best value. As far as the Nomad panels go, I would not recommend the Nomad 7. I think it's just a little too small and it doesn't work very well in less than ideal conditions. I would go for the Nomad 20 personally, as I think it's going to meet most of your mobile needs and save you some money from the Nomad 28. Additionally, the Nomad 28 concerns me a little bit when the glue comes undone and lets the kickstand fall off the back. My recommendation would be the Nomad 20 for portable use and the Boulder 100 for base station use. Thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, please like, subscribe, and share this video with a friend. It really helps the channel out. Don't forget to check us out on Instagram and Twitter, where you can find behind-the-scenes content for some upcoming videos. Cheers!